Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner. I'm available for code reviews and on-site training. In this episode, we're going to spend some time looking at Clang's time trace facility. We will apply it to a real-world project and we will attempt to actually reduce the compile times of this real-world project based on the knowledge that we gain from this analysis. Now, before we get to that, I do want to remind you that I am available for training. There is a link in the video description for how to get here to see more about my training offers, which are geared towards companies. I have been working on books related to C++, which you can find links to in the video description as well. And all of these episode ideas are driven by you from my CPP Weekly project on GitHub, so make sure you make your interest known for what episodes you would like to see. Okay, so let's start with this analysis of our build time. I am actually going to look at ChaiScript, which is my scripting engine that I started on quite some time ago with JT, whom you may know from the live streams that we have done together. So I'm in the CMake configuration here, and I'm using CCMake, which I actually do prefer for visualizing all of the options that have been chosen here. Now, I don't have any fancy things enabled that might throw off this build time calculation. So I am not doing any sanitizers. I'm not doing any extra analysis. I just have gone in and I've hit T in CCMake here to toggle advanced mode. And I've added this extra flag for CMake CXX flags debug of dash F time dash trace. And again, this is with Clang. So once the program has been configured with that option, we just want to compile. And I'm going to do a quick make clean to make sure that nothing is going to throw us off here. And just for good measure, let's go ahead and clear our C cache as well. Okay, so I'm going to do a user bin time make chai. So I'm just going to build the main executable, and I'm not going to do a parallel build for this particular time test, but we'll see the results of this in just a moment. Although I might enable verbose equals one here, just so we can confirm that we are in fact passing the flags that we want to our build, and I'm doing a debug build. So if we want to, we can actually look in here and see what warnings are set and what C++ standard is set. And we can see this dash F time trace. So we're doing a debug build and you can see the debug flag is passed as well. Now, interestingly, clearly ChaiScript needs some update. I haven't worked on it personally in quite some time, but we can see that we are getting warnings with our modern Clang analysis here telling us that we're using reserved identifiers in this short ELEC file that we borrowed from someone else. Should probably take a look into that. I will speed these builds back up later so you don't have to sit here through the whole thing. Okay, so what we saw is 1 minute and 4 seconds to compile these three files. And we're going to go down into this directory where main.cpp.o was created. So you can see here we are in this chaiscript-build-time/build/cmake-file/chai.dir/source. And what you might observe is this JSON file that has been created by the compiler for us. This is intended specifically for inclusion in Chromium, actually, or Chrome. Chromium depends on what version you're using, but the Chrome engine. So if you've never seen this before, you just open Chrome and you go to Chrome:// tracing. And this is meant for the visualization of, well, trace logs. So we're going to go ahead and load up this map.cbp.json file. And we see a flame graph of everything that the compiler had to do to build our code. Now, there are approximately three things that we want to look at. Using Compiler Explorer as a notepad here, as one does, of course, we need to, again, look at three things. We might have expensive header includes that should be moved to our list of precompiled headers. That's not a great solution for TriScript because that doesn't affect the average user of TriScript unless we want to require them somehow to use our same PCH list. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time looking at that. Number two is template. This is looking at template instantiations to reduce or eliminate. We're looking for particularly expensive templates and thinking about whether or not we can de-templatize code. Now, creating new template instantiations is rather expensive in the compiler. And number three is function templates to extern for our users. Now, I strongly recommend that you check out my episode on extern template for functions. That might actually be a very good use case for TriScript, but it has a minor problem in that currently I guarantee that TriScript is a header-only scripting library. So if you actually wanted to use it after I provide these extern template things, then that adds an extra level of complication for the users. Now, that is specifically episode 330 that you want to check out for more information about that. Okay, so here we are back at our flame graph, splitting this up front end and back end. And these source things, we can just click on this and we can see that IOStream specifically spent 357 milliseconds wall clock time being parsed by the compiler. So that is something that we could move to our PCH list. All right, now the next large source file that we see is, oh goodness, that's standard regex. Now we all know that standard regex is expensive to include. So that's an extra 322 milliseconds on the wall clock for including regex. What a shame. Now the next thing is chiscript_basic.hpp. That's 1.2 seconds just including and parsing that file. Well, that really sounds like something that should be added to the PCH list if you are using TriScript as a user. I mean, just go ahead and do that right now. If you are a user of TriScript, add this header file to your PCH list, and you just saved 1.2 seconds on every single CBP file that includes it. And these are largely broken down into other TriScript header files underneath here. And if you want to, you can start digging in and seeing that parsing this one particular class, parsing the class boxed number, took 148 milliseconds all by itself. And parsing the class dispatch engine took 222 milliseconds. Turns out I can zoom this interface for you a little bit here. Moving forward, we've got this perform pending instantiations, and then we have this opt module down here. This is 6 seconds on the back end. So this is dealing with all of the types that have actually been created. We're seeing all of the mangled names in here. So I don't think we can directly affect this unless we can reduce the number of types that are being generated at compile time. We can use this one here to zoom in. This is make unique code gen function. Interesting. Make shared. Ordered set. Hash table. Okay. And we see if we have make unique calls unique pointer detail or creates that type, which creates a unique pointer T, which creates this make unique thing, which creates a unique pointer, which creates some other internal make unique pointer data thing and unique pointer impl thing, and a tuple. Tuples are used internal to, here we go, internal to unique pointer. That's interesting. Let's see, what is this? Okay, that's a different make unique call. Vector of module errors. Okay. So we can start to get a feel where if you instantiate too many different vectors, too many different unique pointers, that kind of thing, then it starts to cost. Oh, look, another make unique pointer. Oh, look, another make unique. Okay, another make unique. All right. We're starting to be able to recognize this pattern right here. This is clearly a make unique stalactite, if you will. And they just keep going. There's so many of them. So let's go ahead and look in these pending instantiations as well. Let's see, instantiate function. So this is all the function wrappers inside of ChiScript. And we have this make shared helper here. So there's possibly something to look at here and trying to reduce the amount of time it takes to compile the proxy function callable impl. That looks like it would probably be a good place to look. And we already identified that our uses of unique pointer seem to be coming up. Let's see. Yeah, boxed value of float, boxed value of long, boxed value of car. So why though? Let's see, that creates a any to a shared pointer, which has make unique in it. Interesting. So we can start to see again, all of these calls to unique pointer. And there's many different instantiations of unique pointer. That's definitely something we should dig into. So all of that code was down in the any header. And this is kind of my own implementation of standard any, and this has a long history for why I did it this way. But the specific call to make unique is here. So I'm calling make unique. I would say that I need to make a data impl t. Now, if you watched my more recent episode on a simplified version of standard function, it's the exact same technique here. My any object has a unique pointer to some sort of type erased data type so that I can pass this thing around, copy it however I need to. And then internally, there's actually a type erased thing and it has to do a runtime dispatch. And you can see this override here on this clone function. Okay, so that's so that I can make a copy of it. All right, so this is interesting because I'm following best practices here. I'm saying I need a unique pointer of data impl of t, and I'm passing it this pointer mData that I want it to make a copy of, this object here. Basically explicitly calling the copy constructor. Now, at this point, I want to be very careful with what you take away from this episode. I am not telling you to do what I'm doing. I'm telling you to be aware of all of the different types of templates that you instantiate when you are trying to optimize your builds. So if I were to actually commit this change, I am going to need to make comments as to why I did that. But what I really need to do is reduce the number of unique pointer template instantiations that exist in ChiScript. And I'm going to do that in a very unfortunate way. I know that I ultimately want a unique pointer of data. And I am going to create one of those by not using make unique. I'm going to create a unique pointer of data and I'm going to pass it a data impl t. Now, this works because data impl of t is derived from data. Because this code is called in so many places, it is going to instantiate even one more function call than we ultimately need. Now again, this is hyper-optimization of our compile time. So to avoid any hint of this unique pointer of data impl of whatever this templated type is. I'm going to call new on the data impl t, static cast that to a data pointer, and pass that explicitly to unique pointer. Now note, this is a safe thing to do because I have properly provided a virtual destructor in the base class. Okay, I've eliminated both calls to make unique in my any.hpp. And we're gonna see if I got my syntax right. There's a lot of angle brackets and parentheses to keep track of here. Okay, there we go. This is at 49 seconds wall clock elapsed. This is 47.5 seconds user time. And that was 59 seconds user time or 104 seconds wall clock elapsed previously. That's pretty good. We went from basically a minute, 59.8 seconds, 60 seconds to approximately 47 and a half seconds. That's good, right? That's like about a 25% compile time savings in ShyScript. I mean, that's kind of ridiculous. That's without even really trying that hard. We just looked for the common thing that was instantiated over and over again, and we reduced it. So just to be clear, if I was going to keep this change, I really do need to put a comment here. It would be something like this. And then to avoid the static analysis warnings, I would have to, with the consent of the rest of my team, put a no lint and this comment here. This tool, ftimetrace, can point you in the right direction and you can learn a lot about your code. So we saw how you might identify files for adding to PCH. We saw how you might identify expensive to compile functions that you could move to extern template. Now that wouldn't have worked for make unique in this case because there's just far too many different make unique function templates being instantiated. But we did see a way that we could kind of de-templatize this a little bit in a way. We kind of just avoided instantiating a whole lot of extra templates, and it saved a lot of compile time for a very simple change. So I do recommend that you also check out this article from the author of LibFormat, again, about another technique for avoiding template instantiations, basically. So I will have a link to that also in the video description, or at the very least in the GitHub issue for this video for you to check out. So thanks for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. I hope you learned something. I hope you treat your newfound powers very carefully, but hopefully we can, you know, slow down the heat death of the universe by avoiding so much CPU time on our builds.